In this module, we will continue with our quantum mechanical treatment of hydrogen atom. As we mentioned it already, hydrogen atom is the only chemical system which can be exactly solved using quantum mechanical methods. And last module, we wrote the Schrödinger equation for the hydrogen atom, the total Schrödinger equation, and then using the center of the mass coordinates, we split this equation into two equations. One was representing the translational motion of the hydrogen atom, and the second was representing the electronic motion of the electron. And then we had two equations, one for translational motion and the other was the electronic Schrödinger equation. Now in this module, we will focus on the solution of the electronic Schrödinger equation of the hydrogen atom. And we will notice that how this equation can be further split up into three equations and then solve each of those equations one by one. If you look at the electronic Schrödinger equation for hydrogen atom, it is minus h square upon 8 pi square mu del square xyz psi e minus z e square upon 4 pi epsilon 0 r psi e is equal to e electronic psi e. Now if you look at this Schrödinger equation, here psi e is the electronic wave function and mu is the reduced mass of the hydrogen atom, and the second term z e square upon 4 pi epsilon 0 r is the potential energy term. Now since here we are dealing with the three coordinates of the electron relative to the nucleus x, y, z, one would presume that perhaps this equation could be split into three equations, each representing x, y, and z dimensions. But in principle, this is not possible because of the presence of r in the potential energy term. Because of the presence of r in the potential energy term, this equation cannot be split into three Cartesian coordinate based equations. Therefore, the question arises how to solve this equation. In order to solve this equation, we therefore split this equation by first converting Cartesian coordinates into polar coordinates. We have already discussed in our earlier modules that Cartesian coordinates and polar coordinates, they are linked or they are related to each other. Now using that relation, one can transform the Laplacian operator del square xyz, which is in the electronic Schrödinger equation, into the corresponding Laplacian operator in polar coordinates. And if we do this, the equation looks as it is shown in, it is 1 upon rr, del by del r, then we have r square, del rr upon del r, plus 8 pi square mu r square upon h square, then in parenthesis we have e electronic minus v, v is the corresponding potential energy, then parenthesis close, plus 1 upon theta theta, then 1 upon sine theta del by del theta, then we have sine theta theta upon del theta, plus 1 upon phi phi, 1 upon sine square theta del 2 phi phi by del phi 2 equals 0. So this is the equation which now we have after transforming it into the polar coordinates. Now if you look at this equation, the first two terms of this equation refer to the radial part, while the third term refers to the theta part and the last term refers to the five part. So third and fourth basically are representing the angular part. Having split equations in the polar coordinates, therefore now electronic wave function will be the function of r theta phi, and it will be equal to rr, which is the radial function, and then theta theta and phi phi. This total is the angular part of the total wave function. And this angular part of the wave function, as we have also learned earlier in our study of rigid rotator, this is called spherical harmonics. Now we will look at the radial and the angular part separately and solve them one by one. Let's start in the following way. The radial part of the equation, as you can see here, in this we make the substitution that this part is equal to beta. And therefore, this equation will be called RR equation or radial equation. Once this substitution is made in the main equation, our equation modifies to beta plus 1 upon theta theta, 1 upon sine theta del by del theta, sine theta del theta theta by del theta, plus 1 upon phi phi, 1 upon sine square theta del 2 phi phi by del phi square is equal to 0. So this becomes now the total electronic Schrodinger equation. If we multiply this equation by sine square theta, we see we reduce it to a simpler form and we get an equation which looks like, as you can see here, beta sine square theta plus sine theta upon theta theta del by del theta, in parenthesis sine theta del theta theta by del theta, plus 1 upon phi phi del 2 phi phi by del phi square is equal to 0. Now in this equation, we put 1 upon phi phi del 2 phi phi by del phi square is equal to minus m square. And we call this as the phi equation. Here m, as we will see later on, is called the magnetic quantum number. After making this substitution for the phi equation, our total electronic Schrodinger equation reduces to as it is shown. Now one can see that this equation depends on theta theta, and phi 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 and equation radial, they depend on r. Therefore, we can now solve each one of these equations one by one. Let's first focus on the solution of phi equation. If we rearrange the phi equation, delta 2 phi phi by del phi square plus m square phi phi is equal to 0. So this is the phi equation. Now, what is the general solution of this equation? The general solution of this equation, as we have also seen it in the case of a particle which is moving in a ring, is given by phi phi is equal to n e to the power iota m phi. So this is the solution of the phi equation. Here n is the normalization constant. Now if we apply normalization conditions as we are doing it here, you can see that the limits are from 0 to 2 pi, because phi varies from 0 to 2 pi. And then if we solve and apply normalization condition, we get n is equal to 1 upon under root 2 pi. So that becomes the normalization constant. After having calculated the normalization constant, we have resulting phi phi value, and that is equal to 1 upon under root 2 pi e to the power iota m phi. And here m, as you know already, can have the value 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on. This, if you remember it, this was also the solution for a particle moving in a ring. After having solved phi equation, now we focus on the solution of theta equation. As you have already seen, depends on theta theta and has the following form. Sin theta by theta theta, del by del theta, sin theta del theta theta by del theta, plus beta sin square theta minus m square is equal to 0, where m can have the values of 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, and so on. So that's basically the corresponding theta equation. Now, how to solve this? This theta equation can be solved, as we had already seen also in the case of a rigid rotator, by transforming this equation into Legendre's equation. And Legendre's equation, if you remember, is of the following form, as you can see here. Now, how to transform theta equation into Legendre's equation? So this can be transformed if we make the following substitutions. We substitute x is equal to cos theta, and then it would lead to 1 minus x square is equal to sin square theta, and 1 minus x square under root is equal to sin theta. So that is basically one substitution which we are making. And then from this we can also notice that dx will be equal to minus sin theta d theta, and theta theta will be equal to px. If we make all these substitutions in the theta equation and further simplify it, ultimately, as you can see through these modifications, we ultimately get the correspondingly this equation. This is 1 minus x square d2 px by del x2 minus 2x del px by del x plus beta minus m square upon 1 minus x square whole parenthesis closed px is equal to 0. So this is the total equation. Now this equation is identical to Legendre's equation if we have beta is equal to L into L plus 1. And that is another substitution which we make now. And this L is known as you all know, azimuthal quantum number. Now, once we make this substitution, then theta equation ultimately reduces to Legendre's equation. And for the Legendre's equation, the corresponding solution, you already know, is given by the relation PL absolute MX is equal to 1 minus x square raised to the power absolute m by 2 dm by dxm PLX. In this, PLMX, as we saw it in the context of rigid rotator, is called associated Legendre polynomial of degree L and order m. And PLX is given by the Rodrigues formula, which is as follows. PLX is equal to 1 upon 2 to the power L, L factorial, dL by dxL, x square minus 1 raised to the power L. So various values of PLX for different values of L are shown in this table. Here, one must remember that the absolute value of M would always be less than or equal to L. The value of absolute M cannot be greater than L, because if absolute M is greater than L, then the value of the associated Legendre's polynomial will become 0. But please remember, x is ultimately equal to cos theta. That we should not forget. And therefore, theta theta, the theta function which comes out of the solution of theta equation, is equal to nlm pl absolute mx. Here, PLMX, as we have discussed above, is the associated Legendre polynomial, and NLM is the corresponding normalization constant. If this normalization constant is calculated, it comes out to be 2L plus 1 upon 2, then L minus absolute M factorial divided by parenthesis L plus absolute M whole factorial square root. And if we substitute it, then we have the final value of theta theta. After having done so, now we have been able to calculate the entire angular part, both theta part as well as phi part. And therefore, total angular wave function will be given by y theta phi, that is the spherical harmonics is equal to theta theta phi phi. And if we substitute the values of both theta theta and phi phi, we ultimately get, which is y theta phi is equal to 2l plus 1 upon 4 pi. Then in the numerator we have l minus absolute m whole factorial, then divided by l plus absolute m whole factorial pl absolute mx e to the power iota m phi. And l is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, and minus l is less than or equal to m, which is less than or equal to plus l. That means m will always have values ranging from minus l to plus l, including 0, and that would mean total l plus 1 values. Now you notice that our purpose was to solve the electronic Schrödinger equation. And our total electronic wave function, which is a function of the three polar coordinates r, theta, phi, is given by rr, which is the radial function. And then we have the spherical harmonics y, theta, phi. Now, spherical harmonics we have been able to calculate. As you can see, we have the angular part, and then it is to be multiplied by the radial part to get back the total wave function. Now, the only problem we are left with is the solution of the radial part. And that is what we will do in our next module. To sum up, in this module, we have seen how electronic Schrödinger equation is transformed into polar coordinates. And this became necessary because of the presence of the potential energy terms in the form of R. So we have the electronic Schrödinger equation. Then we split this equation into three equations. One was the radial part, and one was theta part, and one was the phi part. Of course, the three parts are interdependent. And we also wrote that the total electronic wave function will be the function of R, that means the radial part, RR, then theta, theta, and phi, phi. So we have been able to solve in this module both phi part and theta part. Our phi part comes out to be equal to 1 upon under root 2 pi e to the power iota m phi, where m varies from 0 to plus minus 1, plus minus 2, etc. Whereas the corresponding theta part is equal to 2l plus 1 upon 2 l minus absolute m whole factorial divided by l plus absolute m whole factorial, then pl absolute mx. So we have done that, and we have been able to get both theta and phi part, and thus spherical harmonics. In our next module, we will focus on the solution of the radial part and try to get the value of r.